you were able to say something.
Yeah.
A question. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Salaam wa salaam wa ala ashraf al-anbiya wa al-mursaleen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Today we will deliberate on the thesis of Mesut Idriz. And we had a meeting last time. I think that the title of it has been slightly changed, and he has done that. And but before I am not going to say anything very much. I'm only asking Professor Ipsirli, the supervisor, to give us a resume of the whole thesis and its importance. Thank you.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. This is an excellent opportunity for me to be here among the most distinguished scholars of ISTAC and also to supervise a thesis which is the ideal for important target for me working on the Balkans. From Professor al-Attas several Saturday night lecture, also I remember that Islam was introduced twice to the Europe. The first one is through the very early in Islam, during the Umayyad times, and almost 800 years Islam survived in Spain, but unfortunately at the end of the 800 years, end of the 15th century, they just expelled the whole things and they killed most of the Muslims at that time. Second important experience was the Ottoman experience in the 14th and 15th centuries, beginning of the 14th and 15th centuries. And of course, the Muslims in the second time, while they are trying to introduce Islam to the Balkans, to the Europe, they were very careful and they, I think, calculated most of the problems, etc. And they spent almost all their energy, all their efforts, all their treasury, because I know from the various documents, to establish the Islam in the Balkan Peninsula, in the Eastern Europe. And of course, this is only not through the wars or the campaigns. For example, I have a little survey, little study on Bulgaria. Only in Bulgaria, there were 4,000 mosques, madrasas, fountains, and bridges, etc. Only in Bulgaria. And altogether in the Balkan area, I think there are something about 15 or 16,000 Islamic monuments were built up. Unfortunately, most of these Islamic heritage now destroyed. Only few of them were survived. So, my graduation thesis from the university in 1967 was about the Ottoman court registers. And from that time onward, really it was an ideal, it was a dream for me to work on these court registers and especially on the Balkans. But to work on the Balkans, there were some requirements. First of all, to know the local languages. While you are reading these sources, there are a number of difficulties. And the first thing, you should know the local languages and some problems over there. When I came to ISTAC as a part of the teaching body, of course, I had a nice friends, very hardworking students, and Mesut was one of them, actually. And I noticed that he knows Arabic because he spent 7 years in Damascus, 3 years for the high school and 4 years in the university. So this is one good advantage. Secondly, he knows of all the local languages, plus Turkish, which is almost his native language. So I said that this is one of the, my achievement that I should focus on this young gentleman. And I visited Professor al-Attas and Professor Van and explained them. He has such a privilege that he knows Arabic, he knows all the local languages, Albanian, Macedonian, and Serbian, plus Bulgarian, and of course as a native, as a Turkish language. So I would like to direct him to the Balkan studies. Just previous to my visit, there was a project in ISTAC that some court registers from the Bosnia, which is the Gazi Hüseyin Library, there are, I think, around about 300-400 court registers, which I visited in 1990, just before the war. Luckily, ISTAC made a project that all these sigils, court registers, should be taken as a microfilm form to ISTAC. So it was another encouragement for me that this will be second attempt, perhaps in the future, ISTAC also being interested to get the Macedonian sigils or Macedonian documents to ISTAC library as a part of their collection. So both of them, they said, it's very good if you can supervise and give him some support. That will be very good for ISTAC because, especially Dr. Professor Van Setter, it is one of our primary interests to study the Balkans, Islamic Islamization of the Balkans, how the Islam entered to that geography, how it, what was the venture of the ISTAC over there. So we started first as an MA thesis on the ijaze, Balkan ijaze in the Islamic educational system. What he did, Mesut himself, he collected about 12 or 14 ijazet name, ijazet diploma from the Balkan cities. I think one of his grandfather's ijazet. So he studied all these ijazets. Of course, as we know, the text was worked in Arabic. He had no problem reading the Arabic. So he analyzed, he established some sort of tradition about ijazet. And I was really thankful to Professor Attas and Professor Wander. Later on, they published this thesis, the main part of the thesis, in the Al Shajara, which is the one of the leading journal in our field. So this was also one of the very happy moment incident for me. So after finishing his ijazet, in the meantime, I suggested him that he can study the Balkan cities, taking one of them as a case study, concentrating on Balkan cities. But I said there are a number of difficulties, number of problems. I know that there are several studies dependent on the court register in Anatolia, in the Arab cities, like in Egypt, Damascus. Thanks, Ustaz. He said that there's also one for Sudan, depending on the court register. But we don't have the specifically any thesis dependent on the court registers in the Balkan cities. Because there are a number of problems, reading, analyzing, etc. So these things developed very smoothly, and we started reading, analyzing, he classified all these things. It was, I think he had a number of difficulties getting these documents from the archive. It's not in the library, not in Istanbul, directly in the Balkan, in the Macedonian archive. So he had such a problems. And finally, everything was ready in his table, he started working very hard, and I think three or four times he visited again. I really can't go to ISTAC. They provided some sort of financial facilities to come to Istanbul, because I was in Istanbul throughout the, his studies. He came three or four times Istanbul, spent 3 weeks, 4 weeks. We tried to settle down the, some problems in the meantime. So ultimately we came here to the conclusion. Of course, the title of the thesis or the about the chaptering the works, etc. I had my suggestion, and later on I understood that, especially in the first title, I had a little bit mistake covering the, you know, the, in general, thanks to Ustaz Müddessir and Ustaz Cah, they gave this notice to me, and also the Professor Moussavi and Dr. Ismail just gave me some warning that it should be like this, like that. So, taking all these warnings, we organized and we changed the Mesut changed the titles, and he reorganized the, his work, and he produced this study. And here there are mainly three chapters. The first one is actually given, perhaps Mesut himself also gave some detail about it. There are the, you know, physical appearance of the Macedonia and monaster particularly. Then the officials in a Balkan city. Of course, there are two types of officials. One is the judicial officials like Kadi, Nali, Muhsir, etc. Plus there were some administrative officials like Sancak Bey, Subaşı, or Çavuş, etc. This, if you don't mind, I would like to give just a few words about this judicial records in general. During the Ottoman time, from the very beginning until the end of the empire, the Ottoman Kadis, they kept their records very carefully. And at the moment, I have a reliable statistic. We have about 22,000 defters, very large, very huge defters in the archives. Almost every Ottoman city, every Ottoman settlement had such a defters. Some of them 1,000, some of them 200, some of them 3, and unfortunately some of the cities lost. For the Balkans, there are a number of defters. In Sofia, for example, there is defters. Sofia sigils was published in one volume, just reading the documents, not the analyzing, by Professor Duda in, I think, 1954 or something like that. Just reading the documents without any analysis. And get so, we, I don't myself remember any studies. I mean, there are, of course, some articles or some chapters about studying the Balkan cities, for example, Ömer to Balkan in some of his studies, or Süreyya Faruki, later on Professor Necat Gül, etc. They use these documents, but not particularly depending on these valuable sources. So we know that Ottoman Kadi had three main functions. One is the of the judicial, as we expected primarily. Secondly, he was the head of the administrative organization over there, because there were no other administrators in the Kaza, in the district. Third one, he had a municipal responsibilities. controlling the houses, cities, or the you know, the market, etc. So we can see all these detail in this work. One criticism, which is really accept this criticism, saying that thesis mostly reflecting the documents and rather than the many analysis or many you know explanation, etc. It is we are in the same field in the historical studies or judicial studies to give a reliable, acceptable analysis. It is not very easy things at first, and unfortunately we don't have the many examples in our hand, many not many case studies. So here perhaps our member of the academic staff would say that there are some sort of lack of the some analysis or comment, etc. But we try to ourselves to be just here, because if we measure himself is just at the beginning of his academic career, if he try freely some comments, something, I am sure that he will make many mistakes. So I said that please be restricted in your comments. Don't go too far, because it is very risky, very difficult. But later on, inshallah, in the light of the various suggestions, in the light of the, some other studies, you can increase, you can expand your comments, your analysis, etc. And one more things perhaps I would say about the thesis. There are here three chapters, and there are more or less balance between these three chapters. The first one is the, about the physical appearance. Second one is the officials in the in a Balkan city. Third one is the social and economic life as far as possible. Of course, he mainly depended of on the judicial records, but in the meantime, he used secondary literature in a very large scale. We can see this in our in, from the bibliography. I am sure there are some also missing there. And one of the advantages here, inshallah, it will be a good example, good case study. I hope some new studies will be done in future in ISTAC or also in some other universities. Concerning the second part of the thesis, there are the documents. I insisted myself that you should include some documents, some vital documents as a supplementary or as a just evidence for your studies. And he himself spending, I think, a great deal of time, including a second volume. There are some spelling mistakes, some reading mistakes in the second volume. I made my also list, perhaps our colleague also will say something about it. But inshallah, in the hardcover issues of the thesis, he will just corrected all these spelling and reading mistakes. So it will be some sort of, in a way, final position. And finally, here I would like to thanks to Professor Attas, Professor Kuban, and all the ISTAC family, to my colleague, they gave me such an opportunity. As I said several times, my ideal study, directing my students to the Balkan studies, so I had such an opportunity here. I really thankful again and wish success to my young fellow Mesut. That's it. I'm sorry for the not the balanced thought, but sincerely I express my feeling about this. Yes.
Thank you very much, Professor. Now, Mr. Mesut Idriz, maybe you would like to say something and to give us your views on what you have written. Thank you.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. First of all, I would like to thank Professor Dr. Syed Mohammed Naquib al-Attas, Professor Mehmet Ipsirli and Professor Dr. Juan Mohammed Nur for giving me and other professors for giving me an opportunity to defend my thesis today. The title of my thesis is Monaster in the Second Half of the 18th Century, a history of a Balkan city with special reference to the to Ottoman judicial records. From my title, it is understood that three major points can be, three questions can be raised here. First, why monaster? And secondly, why 18th century? And thirdly is, why the Qadi sigils? I will start from the first question, which is monaster. Why monaster? The city of Monaster has been considered throughout history one of the main cities in the Balkan Peninsula. It is located on the crossroad of a very famous road for traders called Via Egnatia, which was connecting the Byzantine Empire, I mean Constantinople, with Italy. Secondly, monastery had special status throughout Ottoman rule. Most of the other cities were governed under a special sanjak, special province. But monaster was, throughout history, was not dealing with any of the provinces or sanjaks. Monaster was dealing directly with Pasha Sanjak, which is the porter, the central government. And thirdly, why again monaster was important? Monaster has multi-ethnic and multi-religious society, where you find Jewish, Christians and Muslims that were living in that city. The second question, why 18th century, here is that studies for monasteries before 18th century were done, but it was a bit limited. Some of the studies were based on the Qadi sigils, but they did not really cover the most issues of monastery society. And there are some other studies for 19th century, but the 18th century was a period of vacuum without analyzing, without studying that period. And secondly, why 18th century is that 18th century, as it is known, that it is a transition period where Ottoman Empire was going through the transition from the classical period towards a so-called modernization period. So that is why I choose this century. We can expect that when a society is going through the transition period, we expect a lot of conflicts, a lot of problems to appear in that society, whereas as we can see in the thesis, we don't really find much problems during that period. Now, the question about why the Qadi sigils? Well, as Professor Mehmet Ipsirli pointed out, that Qadi sigils, before 1950s, there were some studies about the Qadi sigils. They were pointing out that how much Qadi sigils are important and how much they are reliable sources. But after 1950s, many scholars, including Harry Linoji, Professor Ipsirli, and Ronald Jennings, and a few others, they really emphasized on the Qadi sigils. They said that the Qadi sigils are considered primary source when we are dealing with the Ottoman history, especially with the certain societies. And in the Kadi series, not only we find authentic Kadi series, not only are authentic sources, but also objective sources are considered. Secondly, Kadi series does not contain only cases related with the court or with law. We find that in the Kadi series, we find two sorts of documents. One is dealing with the cases in the court. Secondly, dealing with the correspondences between the central government and other offices with Kadi. And one point here I would like just to add that Kadi series, I never came across before, I mean, throughout my readings, that nobody claimed that Kadi series can be considered a written record of the process of Islamization, particularly in the Balkans. So how I came to this idea to write about this thesis was Professor Ipsirli suggested to me when I was doing my MA degree here in ISTAC. So I was thinking to work on one of the series for my MA, but we saw that it is very difficult to cover many points, so we left it and I chose it to work on Ijazah. And when I came to when I was offered to continue my PhD in ISTAC, Professor Ipsirli suggested to me this topic, and he said that it is very important. And I went to Macedonia, to State Archives of Macedonia, to search for this kind of documents, and it was really difficult to not only to obtain those documents, even to go and through and read these documents. And I spent a few months to check these records, these books in the State Archives of Macedonia. And I saw that, you know, some of them are readable, some of them are not readable. So I selected some books, and I brought here some of the Kadi series that I have been using for my thesis. The Kadi series were written by a Katib, by a scribe. And it was not really well organized in terms of subjects, in terms of topics. So they were just recording day by day records. It contains documents related to the family life or economic life or other issues. So it was really difficult for me, and I don't really master Ottoman language. I know Turkish and Arabic a bit. Then I asked first help from my uncle who masters Ottoman Turkish, but unfortunately he couldn't help me because this is really technical, very technical, and he said to me I can't do anything. And thank to Professor Ipsirli and a few other professors that helped me to start reading and to get idea how to classify them. And in 6 months' time, I classified all the topics and I put it into envelopes, as you can see here. Each envelope contains a subject. Let's say inheritance, I put all the documents related to the inheritance. Or inheritance related to the me, non-Muslims, I put to different envelopes. With this, I start my thesis. When we come to the point of whether content of my thesis, it was a bit problem, you know, in the methodology, you know, which methodology to use in the to organize or to put the points in the content. I spent time with Professor Ipsirli and I consulted him many times how to organize the points, and we finally came to the conclusion that we divide the topic into three. We start with the topographical and physical appearance of that city, based again on the Kadi series, mainly. And then we go to the ruling class. it was Qadi at that time, and the root or the subject, the Raya, of course in the Raya we find the socio-economic history, I mean it helps to socio-economic history. I went through other writings done based on Qadi Sidris. One of them is here, I wrote here, the Ronald Jennings, for instance, writes about the Kayseri, one of the famous Ottoman city in Anatolia. The method that he used is really a bit confusing, so Professor Ipsirli also was not did not really like the methodology, but he was one of the first who really worked on the Qadi Sidris. And secondly, I have here Galal al-Nahal. He worked about the Ottoman Egypt, about the court records of Ottoman Egypt. His work is a bit dry, the way how he approached it to analyze the Qadi Sidris. So finally we concluded with Professor Ipsirli that this is the only way, or for the time being, the only way, the best way to put the points or chapters. As for the second volume, I give thanks again to Professor Ipsirli. I give some selected documents there that I have been using throughout my thesis. And in my analysis here, I am referring whenever the document is available in the second volume, I am referencing the go and check in the second volume. And that second volume, I did not really put only the documents there. I tried to give a transliteration in Latin alphabet and plus summary in English. So the reader will, for the reader, it will be easier to check and see the problems there. As for the, finally, why this thesis? And who can ask why this and what is this thesis? Well, here, one of the points is that the whole thesis itself is a kind of information and at the same time conclusion for readers or researchers to make comparative studies between past and the present. And not only past and present, the researchers can make a comparative study between monasteries, for example, the monastery society, and other cities during the Ottoman Empire. And another point here is that monastery was not only a part of the Ottoman history, but also Muslim history in general. And today some of the scholars, I don't really want to go into details, to some of Balkan scholars, they say that Balkan was not, it's not a part of Muslim history, and they say just it was a kind of a short period, they occupied the lands and they left the lands. So it is a bit hurting that this kind of document we can prove to them that it was a part of Ottoman history. So with this, I hope I try to cover in general and summarize my work. Although I did not really go into details of the content, I hope professors will have questions and suggestions. I leave it to your professors. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Now we have there are two readers who have been reading through your work, and I would like to ask for their comments first. Dr. Ismail Marchinkowski, please make your comments.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب الله العالمين سيدنا أبو القاسم محمد وعلى صحبه الطيبين بعد yeah, thank you very much for your actually introduction about the significance and also of course Ipsirli's I would like to deal with all my comments here on blog, actually, from the contents and also from the formal point of view. First, I would like to add something on the significance a little bit. Although the method has dealt with, concentrated rightly, as I think, on one particular period, I would like to add something on the significance of Macedonia. And I must add here something. I had the honor to visit Macedonia and also 2 years ago with Professor Ipsirli together, and we met there also. I met your father's family. And it was for me the first impression actually of an Islamic, well, city in Europe. Being myself a convert here, I'm talking a little bit personally here, convert for 20 years, but to see actually how Islam actually, or Islamic culture, civilization was entrenched in Europe from the, well, we can say beginning, maybe mid of the 14th century, yes, up to 2 years before the First World War, actually. And so, as you mentioned rightly here, or I think you're quoting somewhere, that Balkan Peninsula, Rumeli, or Rumeli, we put it like that, was actually, it was the center of the Ottoman Empire, one of the centers, of course, if you disregard now the earliest period, was actually the splendid capitals of Edirne and, of course, Istanbul geographically. So we should see, as you mentioned also, the importance of these kind of documents here for establishing Islamic history, rather than only Ottoman history in Europe. And as it is very interesting, some years ago there was a conference in Munich, by the Southeast Europe Study Center there. They invited people from Greece, scholars from Greece, from former Yugoslavia, at that time I was still Yugoslavia, from Turkey and so on. So all these people actually, they try to disregard this kind of history, 500 years history, just to switch off. It was just an occupation, that's it. But to this kind of document we see that also the significance for the Christian and Jewish community. Significance here of Macedonia in general, I would like, of course you mentioned, and I asked you actually also to rewrite the introduction which you have done, as I think quite successfully, going back to, of course, the Hellenistic period, Alexander the Great, quite interesting, of course, not so much in detail, of course, because not your subject, but you stopped, of course, you mentioned the further course of history until 1912, the First Balkan War, which actually was catastrophic for the Ottoman Empire, the loss, of the European territories and so on. I would have, you know, of course, my interest here would be if you would have added some remarks also on the significance of the Macedonia question in particular. Just two remarks, you don't have to expose yourself, your personal views and all that, but let's say it was very interesting, as I mentioned, 2 years ago we had been there, and the problem there, let's say the significance, that Macedonia doesn't actually stop only the boundaries, actually there's significant territory held by Greece, by Bulgaria, actually also very important question, Bulgarian question in the future, by the way. So I myself actually have dealt with it in an article also on these kind of things, but just from the context point of view here, I would like to say I enjoy the style of your writing, the scholarly style of your writing, so strict to the point. I like that, which is quite rare actually in this field. So because you're dealing with facts here and you present these facts quite, you presented them quite successfully. Yes, you have rewritten the introduction. So I find the study, a general remark, I find it useful for getting a picture of the life, actually, the Ottoman life period. And you have also seen correctly the negative attitude of certain parts of contemporary historiography, in especially Balkan authors I mentioned, I mean, including Greece, or you haven't that mentioned here, but I could add something here, which is considered there, from the Greek point of view, Turkokratia, actually something what is just foreign rule, actually it didn't actually affect the local people, which is totally wrong, of course. And so it is a valuable introduction. With regard to
technical Ottoman Turkish terms with which I had been in my own, when I was sitting in your place, actually, I was also a little bit concerned with technical terms. It would have been maybe advisable to consult also some recent works of Ottomanist scholarship, actually. We can discuss this maybe later. And especially, a very important point is, what I'm missing is a glossary, actually. A glossary of technical terms that would be very important. And you don't have to maybe invent yourself your translation. You can work maybe with, consult certain works. I have added here Linda T. Darling, Revenue, Raising and Legitimacy. It's published 1996, Leiden. We have it in the library. It's a very useful glossary, actually. Of course, this work dealt with the post-classical period, but quite useful. And with regard to the bibliography, I would have expected, actually, and after checking it again and again, that you would add some other works. Of course, you're dealing here only with your, you restricted yourself rightly to a particular field, but as Prof mentioned, Duda's work on the Sophia has been written in German, but of course, at least as a footnote, I would expect it. And then also, there are some technical works here, Reichmann and another Polish scholar, Polish scholars, but it has been translated into English. They have a work on some technical terms. You can go that maybe in the library. It's quite often quoted, actually, and discussing documents. And, yes, bibliography. You know, of course, Professor Ipsirli has the work on 100 pages work on the office of Qazi Asghar, actually, although it's not directly concerned, but I have some remarks also on the office of Qazi, and I think that would be maybe interesting. You know it better as an article in Belatin. Then, I myself have a forthcoming thing. Maybe I'm not that. I was comparing all the things here, so we could discuss this. More and more significant here with regard to the bibliography is I'm really missing reference to certain English and French language Ottomanist journals, Archivum Ottomanicum and others alike, which are all accessible from our library. And in these journals, Turkish authors publish, Western authors publish, whether it's, let's say, publication, translation of documents or interpretations, but I think they should have been checked, actually. I was a little bit surprised, including surprised about myself, why I haven't seen it in the first reading, actually. But this is a quite important thing. Archivum Osmanicum, Osmanli, Arastin Malare, and Turkica, especially the journal Turkica. They have some very important studies on rural life in comparative, maybe in Ottoman Anatolia and things like that. In that regard, I would like to really refer you to Professor Suraya Faruqi. Actually, she has the chair of Ottoman studies in Munich. She is a leading, one of the leading scholars. She published in English and in German also. She has really worked extensively on this subject, and also this I'm missing in the bibliography, actually. Then maybe you might want to consult also John A. Fine Jr.'s two-volume work on the pre-Ottoman medieval Balkan history. It has a quite strong emphasis on Bulgaria, which is just around the corner, actually, but some remarks on the feudal system, maybe also, maybe just at least as a footnote, I would have expected standard works like that. You restrict yourself in this field, so I have maybe just a remark of someone who's a little bit concerned also with a kind of comparative approach, let's say, in Safavid Iran. We have certain offices like Kat Khoda, you have the office also in the Ottoman Empire, so maybe things like that we can discuss maybe later, but this more important is the bibliography, actually, could be added here. Yes, you mentioned, of course, the office Kat Khoda has the origin in Iran, actually. Then, of course, the term monastir indeed is Greek, actually, of course, from monastery, and can discuss it. Finally, I find also interesting in your study because you not only refer to the life of Muslims there, but also interesting personally for me, the situation of converts. You mentioned even some very young people convert. They are very sometimes actually quite touching. If you read this kind of quite dry records, but of course the story behind them, I always might imagine what about the parents, what happened to them, and so on. And it's very interesting. In this regard, actually, interesting also the role of the Jews, actually, the Jewish community in, I would say, Greater Macedonia, actually. I have some remarks on this. You mentioned importance, rightly. The Jewish population in Greater Macedonia was quite considerable, and you mentioned, and some parts even exceeded, or was larger than the local Christian community. Amazing, actually. And in this regard, this is very interesting. This community lasted until the 1941, 42, when actually with the German occupation, which was a disaster for this community. But we should say this was one of the oldest diaspora communities for the Jewish people. And this goes actually before the Roman period. We have even here evidences for Jewish community in Hellenistic times. City of Saloniki, it's not for fun that, let's say, Paul and his Bible, for example, he addresses letter to the people of Thessaloniki. Saloniki is very interesting. And this situation was, by the way, also interesting for the later Ottoman Empire. So this you mentioned rightly. In this regard, I would have been interested, maybe you can find something, it's just a remark, where these people come from, actually. Okay, I mentioned there is an earlier, pre-Christian even background, the Jewish community, but especially in the Ottoman context, we have, of course, as Prof mentioned, the end of the Muslim Empire in Spain. Yes. And if you go, everybody goes now to Istanbul, to the bazaar, maybe in some areas, we see even the Jewish people who have their shops there, many of them, of course, you know that better than me as a future Ottomanist, maybe, they have their background in Spain. And so there are actually two mainstreams here, and that means in the case of the Jewish, you have the Sephardim people and the Ashkenazim people, so we have two communities. They're very interesting, and the focal point Macedonia, and again, Saloniki, but also Monastir. It would be quite interesting if you can find something on that, actually. So that is. But my main point was, and with this I would like to close contents part, my main remark was on the upgrading of the bibliography, actually. In general, I find your historical introduction quite fascinating. Also, the way you develop your arguments, and so maybe a two or three marks, maybe on problematic of what I call Furon, former public of Macedonia, kind of things, because this might, as I mentioned, have quite some bearing of maybe future development. God forbid, let's say in its neighboring countries and territorial claims and all. But this is not your subject, but as you mentioned, significance for life and all that. With regard to the formal editorial point of view, very important point, footnoting again. Footnoting, we discussed that. I must say, I'm a little bit disappointed, actually, and in one way. I ask you to rework it, but in this draft, again, okay, maybe for the positive point for us. You refer to many works in Slavic languages, I think mainly in Macedonian language, which is quite valuable for us who have not the background in at least the Macedonian language. This is interesting. But your references, sometimes what's missing, the year of publication and so on. So in this regard, I have a question, actually. If you have... I don't know whether you had actually all these articles at your disposal, or, you see, which is legitimate. That I myself, when I wrote my dissertation, what I did, sometimes I was quoting articles, which I unfortunately, sometimes we don't have some of them, especially the journal, but I quoted my source, at least, being taken from that article, quoted by this author. These kind of things, in case you don't have the journal, could have been done. So a little bit more careful. Data publication with regard to footnotes. In the bibliography, you have it's the same problem, the same articles in the bibliography. Sometimes you have not the page numbers even in the bibliography. It's very disappointing, actually. So, page numbers for every article, first, last page should appear in the bibliography. That is standard, actually. This can be done. Minor things here with regard to the calendar. We don't use AD for let's say data which are common era. Common era is more CE is more appropriate. Anno Domini, new, year of the Lord, I think for in our context is not appropriate actually to say Anno Domini is year of the Lord Christ. No, and since we are Muslim. So and the common era we abbreviate with BCE before the common era. But these are just minor stuff. This is not only actually many of these teases went to my hands actually these kind of problems. So bibliography technically should be reworked. I mean actually every page has kind of page numbers missing in the referred to articles. And I think that's my thing from here. I think it's quite fascinating. I must say I'm a little bit personal here, interested in that fascinating for the history of Islam in Europe. And I will never forget actually my visit there 2 years ago when we actually went to these on this what they call it, the floor of asphalt, but it's really still the Ottoman. Why? Because Macedonia, I mean, of course, and there's some areas we visited where afterwards there had been war, actually, or some problems. And I can only wish that especially Muslim scholars work more on this subject, which is what I would like to do.
Thank you, Dr. Ismail Marcelowski. Now I want to ask Masoud, have you taken notes of all
yes,
that?
Yes, I have taken.
Now I want to ask you, are you going to answer that now or wait until the other examiner?
I answer better now.
All right.
It will be easier for me. Thank you, Dr. Ismail, for your suggestions and notes. I will start from the last suggestion that was AD and CE. I think generally we are not having that kind of, it's not standardized in ISTAC that system of whether we use AD or CE or BCE.
Not yet, that's true.
Excuse me?
Not yet, that's true. Of course, yes. It's not in the outline, but I mean.
So I was in dilemma which way to use. Thank you again.
Okay. But that can be
operated. End of the day. Because
the AD part is mostly by Christian and not Muslim writers.
Right. Okay. And footnotes.